Hello, and welcome to Family Matters, a joint production between the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and the University of the District of Columbia. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt from the Bowen Center, your host for Family Matters. We want to provide ideas that can be useful in thinking about issues that confront families. So today, we focus on some of the issues of family migration, an activity that is as old as the human. This broad view includes the conditions under which migration takes place and the consequences for those who do. To help us think about this is our guest, Louise Rauseo, who has done considerable research on the history of migration, as well as important work with families that have moved from their homeland. Louise Rauseo is a psychiatric nurse specialist in family theory and therapy. She's a researcher and clinician and on the faculty of the Bowen Center. The breadth of her experience includes a stint in the emergency room of Anne Arundel General Hospital and serving on the faculty of Anne Arundel Community College. Currently, Ms. Rauseo is directing programs in Bowen Theory in El Paso, Texas, and Juarez, Mexico. This has provided real-life experience to expand her understanding of the issues of migration for individuals and for families. I'm delighted to welcome Ms. Rauseo.
Yes,
Louise, good
you.
To see you.
Thank
Glad you.
You
could come.
Yeah, we have a chance to talk some more.
Mm-hmm. Well, in thinking about today's show, it's a little different because we've done topics like obesity or teenagers. This topic mm-hmm. is a lot broader.
Yeah.
And yet, when I was thinking about the topic, every single family at some point has moved.
Yeah.
If you're thinking multi-generationally,
yep,
that
true.
Migration apparently, I mean, it's biologic. It's embedded in every family at some point. If you go as far back as there's been humans, it is part of the human
yeah.
nature to move. And so it fits all families. Now, how far long ago they moved? There's some families that stay rooted for years and years in the same place, but there would be units within that do move out.
That's right.
So I just thought it was an interesting topic, and you've spent a long time thinking about the topic and its influence on the family. And I just thought it would be a real good topic to explore and talk
okay.
about and think about. How'd you even get interested in it?
Well, I think back in the beginning of studying some of Bowen theory, one of the things was doing a family diagram and looking at those parts of the family that you didn't know a whole lot about. And I found all kinds of little branches that I knew very little about. And I was puzzling, why is it that on one side of the family, I knew a lot about the family, on another side it was kind of distant and lost. Some of it was migration. And I was studying the idea of emotional cutoff, and I thought, well, I wonder, what does migration have to do with people losing contact with their family, with their history? And I started thinking about, who do I know that, and I started doing clinical work. And in all the clinical work, I was finding out that there were branches in families that sort of disappeared, that people wouldn't have contact with. And I got curious about how migration fit into that. I think maybe you remember there was very early in my training, I don't know where it was with yours, but one of my colleagues was doing work at Psych Institute, and she discovered that the young people who were having a lot of trouble, who were hospitalized with psychiatric problems, there was an immense number of those that had experienced migration and cut off from the people and from the history of their family. So that just kept me curious, and I've been curious ever since.
Well, you followed the road a long way, meaning you've taken your curiosity from years ago, and
yeah.
now you're down in El Paso,
right?
Working with some of the immigration families of immigration down in El Paso and Juarez. And what are you seeing there that informs you about the nature of what happens to families when they migrate?
Well, I'm not there full time, but I'm there enough. We were there for 5 years full time. Now I'm there periodically doing the programs and teaching, but I'm following people. And every family that I've seen, unless it's a forced migration, where whole populations are forced to leave, there are branches that stay and branches that leave. And so I got curious about who does better. You know, how can you tell? What's the impact?
Well, before you get to that, if you're thinking about the human condition, and we're talking about voluntary migration now,
right,
not forced migration.
No.
Do you have a sense of who within the family system is either selects out or select? What's the process in which migration takes place usually? There's obvious stuff, you know, like famine, things
sure,
like that.
Sure, that's almost forced migration.
Right, yeah. But I'm talking now about just people who choose to leave a home. When you think of how hard that would be to lose your home, leave your homeland.
I think for most, yeah, that's true. I think for most people it means that things have to be pretty drastic before some leave. And some leave with the idea that they're going to do better somehow somewhere else, if it's voluntary. Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting because in some families it's almost like somebody is sent out. It's like, we're not doing so well, we may not make it another generation staying here. You go try it someplace
else.
And
who is the you?
Often it's the most energetic, the one with kind of the go power, that gets to go and see what they can do and come back with, you know, we'll send you out, bring back the news. And a lot of times it is the one with the go power. Sometimes it's the oldest. Sometimes in Ireland, when things were really tough, the oldest got to stay put. They got the land. And the others had to go shift for themselves. But often on this other way, it's sort of sending out the one that can be expected to have success. There's a flip side, though, that when there's a lot of competition, and this is true in other mammals besides humans, when there's a lot of competition, sometimes it's the least effective.
Competition for what?
For resources, for mates. Competition, when things get crowded and there's not a lot available. You got a big family, there's not enough for everybody. It can either be you send somebody out to give you a hand and see if they can give you a hand, or it squeezes out the ones who are least effective. So sometimes it's the kind of like the youngest or the one that hasn't been able to establish themselves that get sort of left off, and they're out. It's like in Ireland, often it was the younger males who had to go find someplace else to survive. They couldn't survive on the land as the population grew and as the land got poorer. So that's been, you know, I think the evolutionary biologists have got an interesting angle on it, and they believe that all of migration, majority, I don't know that they would say all, but the majority of migration is about reproduction and survival. But there's variations in that. It's like,
well, you know, I would have questions about that, because when you're starving to death, I'm not sure you're really thinking about reproduction, unless it's kind of in the abstract way, kind of that if I'm going to survive, mm-hmm. I've got to get out of here. Go someplace where there's food.
Sure, sure. But, and then the opportunities are greater for the next to have a next generation.
Right.
No, I think the survival comes first. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I was aware when I first started being curious about this. I think I saw it much more as, okay, people are, I tried to find out about the German part of my family and thinking, oh, well, there was a death in the family and therefore some people thought that it would be better. This was an opportunity to go to the new land. It wasn't nearly that much choice in it. The death was the one who was the breadwinner. The women didn't have much chance to work. She took her young adult offspring and found relatives in the U.S. and landed in the U.S. and survived and reproduced some more, and they continued a line in the U.S. But I thought, I was really surprised when I got to talk to people how much of it is really a matter of thoughtful planning, and how much is a matter of the biology that says something has to change if we're going to if this family's going to go on, if I'm going to go on.
People always have, I don't care what it is, they have their reality reasons that are usually superimposed on, I'll call it deeper truths, for lack of a better way of expressing it, that there is the deep voice that the people are listening to within mm-hmm. self about how they think about something, but they'll okay. gloss on
sure,
top of it
sure.
the reality reason. Well, you mm-hmm. know, there was the famine.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. The famine, it could be the thing that 90% of the families would say, but there would have been other things.
Right.
That was the other piece I got really interested in, is how often is it something of the emotional process in the family? All of a sudden, somebody in that family doesn't feel like they fit.
Well, see, that was what I was getting at earlier yeah. with that earlier question, that there is a family process that sounds like helps to make the decision
as to who's going. Right, absolutely. Right.
You know, if an older child gets more than a younger child, then the younger kid says, well, I don't need this, I'm getting out of here. In other words, there's whatever the decisions are made at the parental level, or even probably among siblings.
That would be the competition
okay.
thing piece, I think. I think there's a more subtle piece too. I think it's very hard for people to acknowledge some of the more, maybe things are not out in the open in the family about somebody gets more than another, but people feel like things are not right and they're going to get out and do something better, go someplace else. The whole idea of cutting off from the family that you come from, I think is something that I don't think we understand really very well yet. I think that that's part of
it. Do you have any evidence from how much wills get into this, the death of like the final parent, and then the siblings are in it with each other, and then that produces a migration in one or some of the kids? Is there any evidence on that?
Yeah, people have tried to study that. There's one or two good studies that look at the adults leaving a particular part of the country where there's good documentation. But they've found that they will say, okay, if this family has enough land and enough money that gets spread around, there's less likelihood that they're going to move way out.
Mm-hmm.
If there's not enough, then somebody's going to get it. There will be choice of somehow. And each family's a little different, who gets to stay and who gets to leave. If they're very wealthy, they may have more money to allow somebody to go find something better, too. So that it ends up, they can do these wonderful studies and end up missing, I think, the piece that Bowen theory adds, which is that there's an emotional process that this other stuff fits into. The fact that things are more equal in a family, or the fact that there's a lot of competition, I think that comes up at an emotional level that unless you can really know your history, your own family history, you don't always know. When their family stories will tell you, okay, well, you know, this family left because father was mean and cruel to these particular kids in the family. You can get more information sometimes from archives that tell things that happened in that family before this group left, that had less to do with dad's personality, but more to do with the things that happened. There was one family the family just sort of fell apart after the adult male was killed in the Mexican Revolution. It turned out, and nobody understood why that family was just in distress, huge distress. And one after another, either they left or they died of his offspring and his wife. And the few that were left and ended up at the border couldn't find any information about it because the people would just cry if they brought up the subject. nobody could really spell out the events that took place. Turned out that this man who died had been chosen among three brothers to serve as the representative in the revolution. And he was in for, because the others had other things to do in the family. Turned out that he was killed almost immediately when he went in. And the family reaction to him being chosen to serve, there was so much conflict around that, that the emotional intensity seemed to just go like a river. It just flowed. And so pretty soon that whole branch was gone. The other branches stayed. And turned out when somebody got back there to find out the facts.
Well, let me ask you this. Yeah. You're adding here an illustration of something that was pretty emotionally intense.
Yes, exactly.
Do you think that just the emotional intensity then influences the nature of the success of migration or its failure?
I think it's a huge part of it.
Positively or negatively?
Yeah, Well, I would say if the intensity that I've run into is pretty negative. I haven't seen much intensity of that nature that wasn't pretty hard on people. That there's a level that I don't think you can find that kind of joyful intensity as easily.
Well, I hear that.
It's a negative stuff, and when people get back to the older generation that stayed, the generation's still carrying the guilt about that. And so you get that together and you realize that what people were saying was we left because the country was poor.
Is true.
That was true. But those who stayed have done fine. Mm-hmm. But they also,
people have been equally as poor and equally
and
as
have
starving
done okay.
and have stayed.
Have
and
stayed.
I think that's what makes it so interesting about who is it that goes and who doesn't.
But I think the success you're talking about, or lack of success for those generations, has a great deal to do with the intensity mm-hmm. around the events that preceded. And it's not the personality necessarily of the guy who was, you know, that people would blame, or just the poverty.
Well, thing that is new on the scene with migration is how, as a human species, if you look at the world's population, we have never had as many people on the earth as we have right now, and that the opportunities of finding unlived upon, in other words, the unlived upon land, for example, there is not, for example, the opening of the West. And what is left that is not inhabited is uninhabited because it's a harsh,
very poor,
place to be. So that that has to up the ante on migration a bit.
Well, I think it does.
If not greatly.
And the population squeeze from within a particular area, then some of that overflows out. And out into something else where there is already a fair amount of people. Mm-hmm. So that really does increase the distress around it. But if we have been seeing this overpopulation piece as part of it, there's also the problems with the environment. And so the environment is less able to sustain. And as that happens, there are more people displaced. So the movement of people is huge right now around the whole planet. You just have to turn on the news and you will see another group of people who are no longer able to stay in their own territory, and they're moving on. So I think that has to do with the intensity of all of society right now. The process in society is so heated up around so many things, but the environment being one of them. And the droughts and the changes that really do send people off searching.
Would you then be predicting that there would be more migration or less migration in the next few years?
It looks like it's going to be much greater. Much greater and much more chaotic. There are some huge predictions. There's something like the number of, I've meant to look that up, something like in the billions of people who are environmental refugees. It is growing phenomenally at this point. And the predictions are just ever increasing.
And these are individuals or families?
It's whole populations. It is, this is
like entire towns or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's more than families.
Yeah.
So that puts another whole look on whether there's choice or not. You know, whether people have that, the ability to choose. And as that increases, the anxiety goes up in society, and the chances of people being able to work that is much less. There are, you know, they don't have the same ability to just have time to think and renegotiate a new place. The animal studies are wonderful in this because they do show the risks of animals in migration, very similar to what we have in humans. Used to be that primarily the young males were the ones who would go out, find the new territory. Well, in some of the other primates, the young males are out looking for a new spot to be where they can put out, they can settle.
Have territory,
have youngins. Something like 50% of the rhesus macaque monkeys that migrate don't make it. So the young males, it's a big risk. Well, it used to be in the humans, I think, that there was this, it was more the young males who were out going to find their new location. It used to be the next town. Sometimes now it's the next country to find a place where they can be. And there's huge risks in it that have always been there. But now it's larger groups that are moving in the same kind of desperation, I think. So it is not a very happy picture, and my interest has been in what helps people to really ground themselves and establish themselves when they are trying to make a new life. What allows them to do a decent job of that?
And what would you say are the major things that need to be done to do that?
Well, I don't have much experience with these environmental refugees.
Right, but you do with families.
With families, yes. I think one of the huge pieces in that is maintaining a connection, knowledge of their past. Not just knowledge, but that's a huge piece of it. And connections to those who are left behind. These days, it's very easy. I met a woman at a meeting recently who was from Russia, and she said the first thing they did was buy a phone card.
And oh, well, the internet also.
The internet also, if they're lucky enough to be
do email every day.
Right, or webcams. Mm-hmm. People are in contact. I think I have seen a huge difference in people who've been able to maintain contact. And it's almost like they can just set up a visit with Aunt somebody down the street by way of the internet or the phone or the webcam. Makes a huge difference. But when it's in an emotional reactive state, like this rather dramatic one, people won't do that.
Right, if you're running from something.
Yeah.
And you're mad at the whole group.
Mad or hurt or whatever the mm-hmm. nature is that, or you don't think they want to be in contact, you know, because that's a huge thing. People will say, they don't want anything to do with me. Well, you know, life changes. And people who are willing to make that effort often are surprised that they can do it.
Well, I hear that. And this whole subject of cutting off versus staying in contact, I think would be a wonderful subject for a future show, because there's so much that goes into what happens with cutoff. And if I'm hearing you accurately, there's benefits from staying connected if you can find a way. And it sounds like it's a lot easier now than it's ever been.
Absolutely. It's amazing that there's that facility. Even while this whole world is moving so fast from one place to another, the opportunities to be in contact are still pretty great.
In spite of, you know, you get a lot with migration. There's poverty involved, but even even with poverty, the internet, it's amazing in terms of there's places that you can go in almost every little town, like the internet cafes.
And, right.
I know of a little town over in Delaware where there's a lot of students that show up in the summer to help out, and the internet cafes are just swamped with the students because they save their money and their time to be able to get on the internet to stay connected to their families. So,
well, there's some big projects around the world of providing laptops for kids in real poverty situations, so that there will be, I think, the opportunity more and more for people to stay in contact. What I think is,
but you got to like the others that are left enough that you want to do that.
That's the part we can pick up another time, I think, is what happens. Because in the process of leaving, most of the time, people don't leave with everything resolved. No matter who you are, I think you may be leaving with unresolved parts of your life and the relationships you're leaving behind. Mm-hmm. There are huge... this context takes place more in the people that I've seen around the Holocaust, where there have been so many emotional issues that people who left before got away, survived, have difficulty getting in touch with the pieces of the family that are left behind, because there's a whole sense of who won, who lost, and who had the better deal. And so that's a huge problem for people to maintain contact.
These are some of the complexities that get into the whole issue of migration.
Absolutely.
Hope you'll come again and we can explore some of this, and the issues of cutoff would be very good.
Okay.
So thank you for being here
today. Thank you. Yeah, we'll begin.
Thank you for being my guest on this edition of Family Matters, and thanks to each of you for watching the show. We're glad you tuned in, and we hope you will watch other shows in this series. If you're interested in learning more about the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family, you may contact the center by calling 202-965-4400 or by internet at www.thebowencenter.org. Thank you for joining me for this edition of Family Matters, and I invite you to join us again. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt, and your family does matter.